a mountain. Looked all around, couldn't find nobody. Went down into the deepest valley. Looked all around down there, couldn't find nobody. Couldn't find one to compare to your grace, your love, your mercy.
Nobody greater than you. Searched all over, couldn't find nobody. I looked high and low, still couldn't find nobody. Nobody greater. Nobody greater, no. Nobody greater than you. I searched all over, couldn't find nobody. I looked high and low, still couldn't find nobody. Nobody greater. Nobody greater, nobody greater than you.
The trouble isn't so much that we don't know enough, but it's as if we weren't good enough. The trouble isn't so much that our scientific genius lags behind, but our moral genius lags behind. The great problem facing modern man is that the means by which he lived have outdistanced the spiritual ends for which we live. So we find ourselves caught in a messed up world. The problem is with man himself and man's soul. We haven't learned how to be just and honest and kind and true and loving. And that is the basis of our problem. The real problem is that through our scientific genius, we've made of the world a neighborhood. But through our moral and spiritual genius, we fail to make it a brotherhood. And the great danger facing us today is not so much the atomic bomb that was created by physical science, not so much that atomic bomb that you can put in an airplane and drop on the heads of hundreds and thousands of people, as dangerous as that is, but the real danger confronting civilization today is that atomic bomb which lies in the hearts and souls of men, capable of exploding into the vilest hate and into the most damaging selfishness. That's the atomic bomb that we've got to fear today. Problem is with the men, within the heart and souls of men. And when you discover what you will be in your life, set out to do it as if God Almighty called you at this particular moment in history to do it. Don't just set out to do a good job. Set out to do such a good job that the living, the dead, or the unborn couldn't do it any better. If it falls your lot to be a street sweeper, sweep the streets like Michelangelo painted pictures. Sweep streets like Beethoven composed music. Sweep streets like Leontine Price sings before the Metropolitan Opera. Sweep streets like Shakespeare wrote poetry. Sweep streets so well that all the hosts of heaven and earth will have to pause and say, here lived a great street sweeper who swept his job well. If you can't be a pine at the top of the hill, be a shrub in the valley. Be the best little shrub on the side of the hill. Be a bush if you can't be a tree. If you can't be a highway, just be a trail. If you can't be the sun, be a star. For it isn't by the size that you win or fail. Be the best at whatever you are. We must come to see that the end we seek is the society at peace within itself. A society that can live with its conscience. That is the real basis of our problem. If we are to go forward, we must go back and rediscover that these precious values. that all reality hinges on moral foundations and that all reality has spiritual control. Welcome to the Man Cave TV show. Welcome. I know I did not give Dr. King's inserts in his speeches justice that they are due, but this is the Man Cave TV show's honor to Dr. Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. I have a magnificent panel with me tonight. Welcome, guys.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for being here. I have the awesome and the lovely author, radio producer, executive producer at WXRP, and public speaker and radio show host, the lovely Miss Charmaine.
Thank you
for being here. And of course, I got the venerable, the outspoken, the agent of the Lord, the CEO of Summit to Save Lives, a regular to the Man Cave TV show's Hard Cold Facts series, Minister Daldred Mason.
Right.
He's back with us tonight.
One more time.
Yes, sir. And, of course, we had Pastor Joe Jackson scheduled to be here with us, but Pastor Jackson's congregation had a death in the family, and as a good pastor, he had to go and tend his flock, and he might have an opportunity to call in and join us tonight, but we wish him well, and we wish him and his family a safe trip. And we will be rescheduling Pastor Jackson to come back into the Man Cave TV show, because he has a wonderful organization that helps young men that we need to know more about. Now, to get into tonight's show, awesome, we have some questions that was posed to us by some of the Man Cave viewers, and I've shared these questions with my panel tonight, and these individuals here with me tonight each have great accomplishments in their own right, and they're going to share with us about their organizations and what it stands for. And this is really a wonderful platform and opportunity for the Man Cave TV show, because, of course, the Man Cave TV show is about finding ways and means to help our kids. And we are especially interested in what's happening with our young men. And, guys, it's gotten really incredible out here. The question comes to most parents right now is, what do we tell our kids to just keep them, you know, safe and keep them alive? We know we have to be concerned about certain things going on out there in the streets, but it stands right now that the very people that are paid and sanctioned to protect us seems to be the ones that we've got to be, you know, very concerned about, you know. Before we get into the questions that were posed online to us, we want to kind of address that issue and see what our panelists have to say about that. What do we tell our kids now, guys, to just keep them alive, to survive this situation and circumstance we're living in?
One of the things I think is to, there are a lot of organizations right now that are telling kids or teaching kids, you know, what to do if you're approached by a police officer. So definitely let's get them that information, that education, because it is real, to know what your rights are, but also know the proper way to deal with the police officer. And I think one of the things that I've been seeing in a lot of videos, a lot of people are just asking, sir, could you just tell me why you're locking me up? And by law, they consider that an interference. When they tell you to turn around, but we think our right is to be able to, well, why can't you just answer this question? And so it kind of heightens the situation. And that is one of the things I've seen in several of the videos. So one, just comply with the officer so you're not heightening the situation, and just get to a safe place, and then handle and get all your questions answered at that time.
Which brings to question right now, and Minister Mason can address this, because I know Minister Mason deals directly with a lot of the troubled youth that are in our court system. What Charmaine just shared with us is very interesting, because so many of our kids right now have these attitudes. They have these attitudes that no one can tell them anything. So in light of seeing that as a part of the character of so many teenagers nowadays, Charmaine was just saying how they should just comply and conform. So how do we get them to understand that it's not a good idea to have these attitudes that nobody can tell them anything?
Well, let me do this. Let me say this first before I even talk about that. There's a young lady that I mentioned to Charmaine about, a young lady that has lupus, and she's has renal failure, and she's been on the dialysis machine. And now she just got a kidney.
Yay!
Amen.
Awesome.
She just got a kidney. But I want to give her mother props. Her mother's name is Kimberly Duke.
Mm-hmm.
A powerful little lady. She's had 8 children, and she's a powerful mother.
Mm-hmm.
This little girl, this young girl, I think she's 14 years old, who just got a kidney.
Mm-hmm.
In the process of me taking her to dialysis and seeing her interact with her mother and interact with her sisters and brothers and things of that nature, this girl is just powerful beyond measure.
Right.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm giving prompts to her for being who she is, and she's healing real fast. The doctor came in yesterday. He was like, man, I ain't seen nothing get better like this. So, you know, I just wanted to give mm-hmm. her some prompts on that.
God bless, yeah.
I said mm-hmm. that first to come back behind her in a way, and what we talked about earlier. You said these kids got attitude.
Mm-hmm.
I think what I've decided to understand more is that they have a low sense of gratitude. And that itself, even in me and uh-huh. this young lady and yourself,
uh-huh.
if we don't have a whole lot of gratitude for things that's going on around us,
uh-huh.
we're going to act like we got a bad attitude.
Uh-huh.
We're going to have a problem with the things that's going on around us.
Uh-huh.
We're going to have a problem with mama trying to get her groove back, but she ain't paying no attention to me.
Uh-huh.
You know what I'm saying? The
uh-huh.
whole nine yards. And then in our communities, I guess it's okay to teach a child to, when the police comes to them, to just be cool, just be okay, just be all right, don't get into any confrontation. But when you got somebody on their mind about racism, when you got somebody on their mind about hurting somebody, that ain't gonna do no good anyway.
Mm.
So sometimes you'll find kids, they will see this. They've seen this before, especially if they come from the street.
Uh-huh.
They've seen police come after them for no reason at all,
uh-huh.
in many occasions, and they automatically have a defense up.
Uh-huh.
That's not an attitude, that's protection,
uh-huh.
okay?
Uh-huh.
So, same thing with me. I remember when I was growing up in Atlanta,
uh-huh.
My parents moved in a white neighborhood,
uh-huh.
to God Almighty, okay? And those Caucasians chased us. This was not, well, this was like 60... we moved in that house in 63, so it was
uh-huh.
right around that time.
Uh-huh.
But this was a middle-class neighborhood. This was not the trailer park, you know
uh-huh.
what I'm saying?
Uh-huh.
This was not the projects.
Uh-huh.
So these Caucasians chased us and belittled us. And I, first day in high school, I got spit on. But I've seen this dynamic of changes that have gone for our lives. I'll say is that for African Americans. And you know me about this history in Atlanta. I am so plugged into this history.
Uh-huh.
But I'm seeing, it's kind of a shame that we've come to another time in life where we've got to fight for our simple rights,
uh-huh.
God's rights, civil rights. We've got it. And I want to remind people, civil rights was not so that we can go in a restaurant.
Uh-huh.
Civil rights was not so I can go to the bathroom.
Uh-huh.
Civil rights was not so I could drink from the regular water fountain. Civil rights was so that I could be a human being.
Okay.
That's
uh-huh.
simply all it was about.
Uh-huh.
All these other things meant nothing
uh-huh.
except for giving me the opportunity to show that I'm a human being.
Yeah.
But now the greatest showing that I think we need to show has to come from us. Before
uh-huh.
we can teach our children how to deal with that mess, the adults need to learn to understand the mess.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
I want to add something mm-hmm. else, because what you said about them feeling entitled.
Yes.
And working with young men, mm-hmm. it's not that they feel entitled. I have to be honest with you.
Mm-hmm.
They feel like endangered species. They feel like they don't have a huge self-worth. Mm-hmm. Not because of they don't believe in themselves. It's because it seems like the world does not believe in them. Mm-hmm. They're always showed in a bad light. Mm-hmm. They get a bad rap before you even meet me, just mm-hmm. because you see me. So I think more than a bad attitude is anger. Mm-hmm. Not being being misunderstood. Mm-hmm. Hearing that my dad's not two many but two pennies from my mama, mm-hmm. even though she doesn't mean me, mm-hmm. but that's what I'm a man, mm-hmm. or to become one. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot that they're not given from their own community to feel self-worth, mm-hmm. to act mm-hmm. accordingly. Mm-hmm. And we have to change that as a community, inside our community first.
Now mm-hmm. let me mm-hmm. you mentioned Martin Luther King.
Yes.
And during that period and era, as you know, my family, I was raised in Ebenezer Baptist Church where Martin was. Mm-hmm. I told her about my story, mm-hmm. about sitting on his knee mm-hmm. when I was a child.
Okay.
But, you know, there was something so much different during that time. It was simply that families had a purpose mm-hmm. for struggling. Mm-hmm. They had a purpose for holding on to one another. Mm-hmm. They had a purpose with an outcome that they look forward to every single day. Mm-hmm. But it had nothing to do with a dollar sign.
Yeah. Okay. At that period of time, I would, you know, think we could safely say that there was a struggle going on. And it seems that within a crisis of a struggle, people are going to be a bit more united and on a front. And that's one of the things that I gathered out of what Dr. King was speaking in one of those sermons there, is that, you know, it's not that we don't have the ability and the genius to achieve great heights in science and technology, but somehow here we've lost that spirit of unity that we once had that you're speaking of, you know, when you were coming up.
And that's one of the greatest tricks of America. Mm. Pretty much every nationality that comes here to America, this isn't just a black thing. Uh-huh. They want to make you think that it is. Uh-huh. Other cultures are being tricked as well. Uh-huh. You remember when Hispanics would come over and do 20 in the house?
Right.
Uh-huh. They would work really hard. Now uh-huh. they have the big trucks.
Uh-huh. That's right.
They won't work for what they used to work for.
That's okay.
And now uh-huh. they've moved out further and further uh-huh. from each other. Uh-huh. And it's one of the American dreams. When you become opportunity,
yeah,
starts to spread people apart. Uh-huh. And like you said, conflict uh-huh. and struggle uh-huh. unifies people.
It does.
And that's one of the things America does to every culture.
Hmm. And very interesting.
Every culture.
And if you take what she just said, that's so profound.
Yes.
The uh-huh. American dream. Let's look at America, how it started.
Well, before we go too deep into that now, because that can we can get on that ship and sail it across the world. We got a caller, and it's possibly a pastor calling in because he said he was going to call. Let's see who this is. Well, we had a call. I don't see it on the line. Are they still on the line? Okay, hold on. This might be the phone. Let's see. Check the phone line, please. In there. Is it plugged in? Okay, for some reason we're not getting a signal out here. Okay, see if the other one will reach. Yeah. Yeah, we'll keep going. We got a caller, but we got to get our phone in order here. No, it's not. Here you are. Let's go ahead and entertain. Well, Mr. Mason, give us a piece of where you were going there. And I apologize for, you know.
Simply, mm-hmm. when you look at that terminology, mm-hmm. American dream, and then I have to, what I'm being reminded constantly, especially today and all the times and the eras that we've had in America was started on killing and taking things from people. They had to divide people to even conquer them. Okay, they had to separate them with alcohol, drugs, mushrooms, whatever they were doing at that time. You know. And so, go ahead.
Yeah, let me get our caller. Man Cave TV show. Oh, Pastor Jackson, great. You joined us, sir. We were expecting you to check in with us. This is Pastor Joe Jackson. Tell us about what's your church, Pastor Jackson?
The Lord Christ Community Church in Norcross.
Okay.
I'd like to say hello to Charmaine and Mr. Mason.
Okay. Yeah. So did you hear some of our discussion, sir?
Yes, I have. I've been watching the show.
Okay. Okay. Great. We understand that you were away tending to some of your parishioners, that you had an unfortunate demise in your family. Is that correct?
Yes, one of our fathers in the Lord passed away, Dr. Frederick Carey of St. Petersburg, Florida. So okay. I came up in services today, preparing here in North Carolina, and we're headed back right now.
Okay. Well, our condolences to the family and loved ones, sir. And we're definitely going to have to reschedule you, you know, to come on. Have you heard some of our discussion thus far?
I have, and I agree with both panelists and what's been said. First of all, I thought just your excerpts from Dr. King's speech at the beginning of the program were powerful.
Oh, thank you.
I also believe that our young black men have a sense of worthlessness, and they have a sense of not being valued in this society. They don't feel respect, and they also don't feel like they have any value. And therefore, many of them have the attitude, you know, why should I go and get a college education? Why should I get a technical college education? Why should I invest in my future if I'm not valued in this society? Mm. The other thing I see among our young black men is a sense that they don't feel that investing in themselves, they don't feel like the community and the companies, the corporations, the companies that could employ them are going to invest in them in return. And therefore, they carry themselves with low self-esteem. They do things that place them in a bad light. And of course, we know about the situation where we're being targeted by police officers.
Yes.
So,
I like that. And I just want to add to this. That's why we have to remind them of the greatness of the black man, not only in Africa, that there were black millionaires in the 1600s.
Right.
See, when you don't know where which you come from just because your physical dad is not present, you have to be able to hold on to something that makes you feel like you're strong. And we have to give them that identity. Not let TV give them that identity. We have to give them that because they really know that they're good.
That's right.
And that's a frustrating part. No, evidently, it looks like nobody else sees that.
Right.
I know that I'm good. We had a session at Holiday Inn, and we had probably about 120 men, young and old, from transitional housing, different places. And I asked them, I said, outside of your family, how many of you feel loved by your community? And not one person raised their hand, and the room, it seemed like time stood still.
Wow.
That's crazy.
Wow.
That's crazy.
Not one black man raised his hand,
right.
And my heart just sank. So how do you expect someone to take care of their family? How do you expect someone to try to be a king when you don't relish my worth anyway?
That's right.
I don't feel like I'm going to live past 18, why do I try to be set up for failure?
That's right.
We have to change those things and the mindset and the way that we deal with our black men in our own community as women, as parents, as neighbors, and everything else. We got to change that.
Absolutely.
Well, guys, I think we'd probably be doing a disservice if we didn't entertain a couple of the questions that our fans are posed to us. the first one here is how do we begin to deal with the outrage over thousands, over 1,000 citizens being executed in the streets each year without trial? Did y'all understand the question?
Yeah, definitely. And I got a plug on that one, brother.
Come on.
One of the main things we're looking at this particular time and period, and there's a variety or a vast amount of things that we really need to understand. But the children, before we can teach them anything, I think most adults today, the ones in corporate, the ones that own their own businesses, the ones that have good jobs, the ones that got mediocre jobs, the ones that could just vote and don't have no job. I think right now we've got to come to a conclusion to educate ourselves or to educate each other on what's going on behind the scenes.
Okay.
What's going on that's pushing gentrification? What's going on that's pushing the privatizing of the prison? What's going on with pushing the laws that incarcerates a young boy for stealing something to where it used to be shoplifting, now is robbery
yeah.
by snatching.
Yeah.
You know, or robbery to attach robbery means the law and the people behind that law is saying we want to put more in prison. We want to put more in jail. We want to get more caught up. And the average child, come on. You know, this is not it saddens me terribly that we have to go through this cycle again to set ourselves free. Well, that tells me that freedom has never come. So we have never been free indeed, according to God's word. We called ourselves free because we could go to the bathroom. We could go to the water fountain. We could go to any restaurant we go to now. We can buy any clothes and go to the mall. Come on, that's not freedom.
Let me. You got a great point there. I want to. Are you still there, Pastor?
Yes, I am.
Okay, I want to pose to you the fourth question on the list. If you had a dream for this society, where do we begin to make a change for a better tomorrow? And I understand you have an organization dealing with young men as well.
Yes, my organization is called When I Became a Man. And what we want to do is take young boys and teach them how to be men of renown, men of wisdom, knowledge, understanding, men that know who they are and know whose they are, men that love their family members and also love the women in their lives as well. And what my sense is this, that I'm going to be doing a series in the month of February called From Slavery to Freedom. I'm going to use Dr. John Hope Franklin's great historical book and parallel that with the book of Romans and the New Testament to talk about being free. And I completely agree with Minister Mason that, you know, we think of the freedoms that we enjoy as freedom. But those are simply glimpses of freedom. They're not true freedom. Because freedom means that your mind and your soul and your spirit are free.
Yes.
And that you don't have these fears and phobias of being ultimately destroyed or having your freedom taken away from you at any moment. Even our voting rights are not permanent. They have to be renewed by Congress every 25 years. As much as we think that voting rights mean something to us, they are limited by the Congress's ability to grant them to us. We could actually go back to the pre-Fifth Compromise or go back to the pre-slavery conditions when we had no voting rights. So those are some of the things that we're teaching our boys, and we're teaching them that until you understand that you are the best. And not only are you the best, but you're
Thank you for sharing that. You're saying we need to raise the standards of expectations upon our young men, and if we do that, then there's a good possibility they'll stand up to them.
Well, now, one thing I want to add about when you said what could we do, one of the things that I'm seeing over and over again, it's like playing chess. We don't play chess very well.
Never have.
Right, and we need to start. They strategically make moves knowing what we're going to fall into. And I'm going to tell you one of the biggest ones that I'm seeing. We fight with emotion.
Right.
Law and logic is not the same. So when we go, we think that's not right. Well, what does the law say? So when you're in a court of law, we have to fight the law with the law. So a couple things. One, we need more of our people getting into politics. We need more of us lobbying. Now, I know a lot of us got to eat. Some of them got so much money, they can stay at the Capitol all day.
That's right.
Whether we're funding some of our people to be lobbying, because the law is the law of the land. Every judge, police officer is sworn in to uphold the law. Not righteousness, not justice, but the law. So we have to be very careful of what's on the book and fighting those things and watching what they're putting. Like you said, they just changed it.
Right.
We should have been fighting them before they changed it.
That's right.
See, we're at work. We don't have time to be at the little meetings that they be doing, nor do we feel like listening to the rhetoric. But we need to pay somebody to listen.
I'd like to ask this question, Minister Mason. How do we develop a sense of trust within for each other within our community? Because it appears that we don't trust each other as a people. The laws are one thing. And just like Charmaine said, that, yeah, we should have been standing and against a lot of these rules and laws that have come, you know, out of the court system. But a lot of our unity is due to just simply a lack of trust in each other. It's as if we don't know each other anymore.
Well, now, that's a big question. Matter of fact, that is a $10 billion question. If you come up with an answer.
Yeah.
Okay, now. All right, so that's like asking also, I had something else in my mind a minute ago, but that's like asking, how can we get rid of racism?
Okay.
We cannot get rid of racism. It's been here, and it's going to stay. But we've got to remember, racism is a profitable thing. Not just an act of a behavior. The only reason why it bothers us so much, because we're not profiting from it. Okay? And that profit that they're making on it, they use it to suppress us. Okay? So there's no color barrier anymore either. So it's not just white folks that's caught up into that syndrome. We've got African Americans that have got caught up in the greed syndrome that's even causing more demise to us, and to our children. When I see single mothers going through trying to survive, and most of them work hard, and most of them try everything they can. I don't care how many children they got. They're fighters. Women have always been fighters in our race of people.
Yes.
And the great thing is, men, and young men especially, they display such a great desire to become something.
So are you saying that greed is what has eroded the trust factor in our communities?
Again, racism, let's go back to the KKK. The men who wore the hoods over their head, ain't that amazing? It was a hood then, and then it was a hood when the brother got shot in Florida, amen? So when we look at those guys that wore the hoods, it was the politicians and the businessmen that put them up to that mess. So that they can scare the hell out of us. So they could, my mothers and my grandfathers and grandmothers, scare them and take their land and take all the things from them. That was a political move. What do you think we're going through now? Another political move, and the only thing about it, it's back then it was just white folks that had the power. Now you got black folks and white folks and other folks that buy into that ignorant power because it's profitable.
Now, trust is something that is earned. I don't trust you because you're black. I tell people, well, some black people I don't really like. Now, there's some white people that I trust, but it's by proving. It's not by color.
Right.
America is the only country that thinks in black and white.
Great point. We have another caller. Welcome to the Man Cave TV show, caller.
Good afternoon. How are you doing this evening?
Oh, great. Thank you for calling. What can we do for you today?
Well, my name is Veronica Santilli, and I have a question for the panel this evening. I'm a great fan of the Man Cave TV show.
Oh,
and
hi.
I just want them to answer this question for me so I can get clarification. Is that all right?
Oh, yes, ma'am, Ms. Santilli. Thank you so much for calling.
I do appreciate it. Well, my question for the panel this evening is that we live in a society of generational curses. Black men are being preyed upon just like they were in the homicide. My question tonight is, when will black history stop repeating itself?
My goodness. Woo!
Well, I'll put it like this. Being a minister, being a counselor, being a man, an agent of the Holy Spirit.
Yes, sir. Amen.
I would literally say it will stop, it will change, and then we can reverse it. I've got a little motto that says, if you can see it, then you can get understanding of it. Once you get understanding of it, you can stop it. You can start changing it and how it affects you in your own life. And then once you can change it, how it affects you in your own life, you can redirect that mess somewhere else where it won't cause a problem to your own children. That's when it will stop.
My goodness.
That's when our history will change. If we don't change, it'll never change. We keep looking for somebody else to change. You know, when I deal with addicts, amen.
Yes.
And I'm teaching them how to stop being an addict. They might blame everybody at first. Amen. But I got to teach them to stop blaming everybody else and look at themselves. We are addicts in this country. We become addicted to doing nothing, saying nothing, and speaking nothing. You remember the three monkeys?
Yes.
See no evil, hear no evil, speak no evil now. Yeah. So we hide from the evil that we see right before us. We try to disguise it and go to work every day and drink every day and smoke drugs every day and be against one another every day. And it becomes addictive to where we try to ignore the reality of what's going on. You said it simple and plain. I think Pastor Jackson said the same thing. We could possibly end up back in slavery again. But it's going to be different this time. It won't be the same old way. It's going to be a different kind of slavery. And I see most of it happening right here now, right now, with the prison systems being privatized. Okay? And they're not just privatizing them. If you look at a map, if I had a map of all the prisons, they're right that most of them, majority of them, are sectioned right near Savannah, right around that area where our number farmland.
My goodness.
You see what I'm saying? So, and I, you and I, brother, we can get rich tomorrow. But we, you and I would not be able to open up a prison. Why? Because you got to have a certain mentality, and you got to go to the certain people to get that prison open. And they're not going to accept us. Go ahead.
It goes back to chess. We know a lot of the things, a lot of the writing is on the wall. We can have 100 people here and we'll be shaking our head. I know that's right. But what you going to do about it? Are you going to see the trap and keep walking towards the trap? Now, the other thing is, what I did not know for years is the Holocaust was done legally.
Right, absolutely.
They set that in motion by law. All the heads of state of the DMV, which we consider the DMV, was told to get down or lay down. A lot of them were scared because they didn't, once they knew what was about to occur.
I'm glad she said
But that. They had all of the information, vital records and everything else of who was a Jew, where you lived at. They had things already set in motion.
That's right. right.
So it wasn't done. I thought Hitler was just a gangster, that him and his boys just went, and no, that's not how that occurred.
That's right.
And that's why I said, again, legally, and if you look at some of the laws, we're
mm-hmm.
set up
mm-hmm.
to go back.
Mm-hmm.
My thing is, we ain't the only one that's going to go back.
Mm.
That's right.
Mm.
So the unfortunate part is some of us are going to unify that don't even, we didn't like each other before, but some of us are going to be eating next to each other
mm.
in different color schemes.
Mm-hmm.
So, again, but I just thank God, because I know he always has a plan.
Yes.
That's the thing that keeps me out of fear
mm-hmm.
and panic.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes our unruly kids, you talk
yeah.
about they so angry.
Yeah.
They're going to be the ones that's doing some fighting, because some of us are going to be scared in the head, and we're going to be scared in the house.
That's right.
And you know, it's so interesting she would say that, Minister Mason, because as you know, when we go into the jails and speak with these guys, we remind them that they are warriors.
That's right.
You know?
Absolutely.
And they've survived a battle, but the war is still going.
That's absolutely. Right. Well, ladies, that's why we have mm-hmm. to understand. They fed us that independent woman syndrome.
Mm. Mm-hmm.
To get our men away from us because of the physical strength.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But please don't forget, we need our men.
Mm-hmm.
It is a need, because God designed it. We
mm-hmm.
need them for more than one reason.
Yes.
So
mm-hmm.
we need to also, as women, get ourselves back in order.
That's
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
We need them for a purpose, and we need to uplift them.
Mm-hmm.
Not put up with their mess. That's not what I'm saying. But we need to uplift them, encourage them, and we need our men back in our community.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll see why in just a little bit, because it's not going to be long.
No.
Not too long at all.
Fast.
Yeah.
And as old Christians or young Christians and real Christians say every day, Jesus is on his way back. That's number one.
Mm-hmm.
And that to me means that there is a great, massive change is on the way.
On the way.
When Jesus comes,
mm-hmm.
change always comes. And in the process of that, those people, and like she said, you know, it's going to be whites, blacks, Hispanics, people from Indonesia, everywhere. This place, this melting pot called America,
mm-hmm.
is going to... The corporate companies and organizations that's pushing the evil, they're going to suffer. They're going to suffer drastically, because when all the people become aware of the real truth, my story is what's really going on.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
And when we identify what's really going on, then everybody is going to be in a motion. And fear, I'm going to tell you something about fear.
Mm-hmm.
Fear can be, even though I teach against fear,
mm-hmm.
because I believe more in faith, okay?
Mm-hmm.
But fear will literally cause a person or an animal
mm-hmm.
to come out of that corner fighting.
Mm.
And they'll come out with vibrant, vigorous power.
Now, is that fear or desperation?
No, that's fear. That's fear mm-hmm. dying.
Okay.
Again, going back on what she was saying, that the fear that young people today... They don't have anybody to care anything about them,
mm-hmm.
you know. And it might get desperate, but that's fear. That the root of that is fear, and that fear will cause a person to strike back. Or, I'll give you an example. You take a man who's under a car, working on a car, and he realizes this car is about to fall on him.
Mm-hmm.
He can find, and I've seen it happen before.
Mm-hmm.
He will find. Automatically, the power.
Yeah, other world strength, yes.
To hold that car up,
mm-hmm.
okay?
Mm-hmm.
He won't know how he got that strength.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But by grace and by love,
mm-hmm.
he'll live.
Mm-hmm.
People who defeat cancers in their body
mm-hmm.
with this right here.
Yeah.
I mean, things happen, and she said, God allows some things to happen. And cause some things to happen for
well,
a particular reason.
We want to, I want to thank Ms. Chantilly, I believe, for calling. Wonderful to know that we have somebody watching.
Saturday night,
yeah. I wanted to pose this question to Charmaine. If Martin Luther King Jr. was alive, how would he answer this question? How would you address the thoughts about careless accusations of racism routinely being thrown around in this country for the purpose of silencing dissenting viewpoints?
Mm.
Wow.
I hope she got an answer for that one.
I do. I have an opinion. I think that some things are based upon racism. I think some things are not. And I think you have to be able to use your discernment for what is or what's not. Because some people do, because they have lived a racist experience, everything to them is, you're racist.
Right.
Sometimes it was you.
That's right.
So again, you have to be able to discern, was that really racist because you didn't like me, or was it because I was loud?
Mm-hmm.
Or was it because I was rude and came in with an attitude?
Mm-hmm.
I think we do have to be careful, whoever is listening, before we start judging.
Mm-hmm.
Get more information on what has occurred.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel sorry for racists, actually. I believe that they have been taught to be that as well.
Mm-hmm.
And that is a misfortune for them as well. So I don't think you just wake up being one.
Mm-hmm.
I think some of that has been perpetrated, and I think they're being used as a pawn by the adversary, Satan, just as well as anybody else. And so
which suggests that a lot of what we're seeing and put in front of us could possibly be distractions.
Absolutely. Yeah. I'm going to tell you, I'm really afraid about some of this police officers getting killed. Because some of this, I'm not sure, and some things we'll never know. If it's the people uprising or somebody trying to cause chaos.
Because
now we do know for certain there was some police officers in Ferguson causing some, trying to start chaos.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why I said sometimes we have to not be so emotional and play chess. Be able to sit still for just a second. We need our wise counsel back.
Right.
People are running amok. And I understand some of our leaders, and I know you out there, it's time to rise up. Don't want to, because the people, they leave you hanging. You know, you out there fighting for people, and then they don't went home. I got to eat. I got to go get the kids. You know? And then you don't have anybody there after the lights are off.
That's an excellent point.
Yes, it is.
Wow, that's an excellent point, because I think that point right there illustrates how so often the trust factor gets eroded, because we don't believe that at the end of the day, the people that we might be representing is really going to have our backs.
Well, I want to add a little bit something else. It's about responsibility, and most of us, we want to limit our responsibility to just doing a little bit or nothing at all. And in the whole masses of the thing, when we had civil rights, we everybody took a responsibility then. Everybody did. The poor, the middle class, and the rich, and so on. They took responsibility. Now we are now going into another era, and I don't call it civil rights anymore. Now it's human rights. It's strictly across the board human rights. And that evil that's pushing against that, literally are pushing us to that. They think they're pushing against it, and they're trying to kill it in a sense, like I talk about trying to kill the history here in Atlanta, Georgia, and I talk about, and I'll call his name, the mayor. I don't really appreciate his efforts. I hear him often say he cares more about the people coming to Atlanta than he does the people that's in Atlanta. The people that's in Atlanta, that's been here all this time, these are the people that made Atlanta. You know? So, nevertheless, we are being pushed to another era of time. And that era of time is going to be conducive to all of our minds changing, all of our characters changing, and all of our spirits, give me a hand, darling, all of our spirits joining hand one more time. But this time, free indeed is on the way. I believe that.
You have a lot to offer us. And so I want to pose this maybe final question to both of you, if we have the time for it, because I think it's pretty heavy as well. Martin Luther King Jr. preached a sermon called Unfulfilled Dreams. The struggle is always there. It gets discouraging sometimes. It gets very disenchanting sometimes. Some of us are trying to build a temple of peace. We speak out against war. We protest. But it seems that your head is going against a concrete wall. It seems to mean nothing. And so often, as you set out to build a temple of peace, you are left lonesome. You are left discouraged. You're left bewildered. Well, that is the story of life. Tell me, how do we change history and live the true meaning of I have a dream?
I feel like this. There's nothing new under the sun. I'm quite sure Moses felt the same way.
He did.
You want to be free, get you free, now you're over here complaining. Okay. I bet you there were more fights after those marches. Amongst the people, why are you drinking out that water fountain? You didn't even make a sandwich.
That's right.
So, this peace that we search for, until Jesus returns, we will not see. Now, I don't say that to disenchant people, but to be realistic, like the Serenity Prayer. Give me the strength to know what I can change. There's a difference. But, you know, trying to change something that you can't change.
And the courage.
To know what you can change.
Courage to know
that's
what
called,
I can.
Right, that's called wisdom.
Yes.
And so I think that we could try to make as much peace as we can, starting with ourselves, in our own home, in our own community, and start to let that filter piece by piece, you know, from person to person. I think that is the biggest thing. And for our leaders, one of the things that God did show me, there's always been a small number of people who make a huge change. There's never a mass of people. Martin Luther King and them were marching well before you see all these pictures with all these people
there. That's right.
The end when the revolution had hit a peak.
That's right.
There were lots of things that were going on before then. And the same way with Jesus. He had them 12 disciples. They was all over the place.
That's right.
You know, so again, for those who feel like, wow, I'm not getting the help, just remember, it has always been done on the backs of just a few. God will always give you what you need to complete his mission, because it is his mission. And we hold on to that.
Wow.
And, you know, just feel good about that.
Such lovely and beautiful wisdom coming out. Such a beautiful face and person. Wow. That's awesome, you know. I think we're running out of time, guys. So I'd like to give everybody an opportunity to make a closing statement, and of course, tell about your organization, how you can be contacted. I want to start with you because I want to let her kind of close it out. Because see, you get to going. I tell you what, I know what you're saying. You want to let the lady go first. But you're going to have to control this thing. So let us tell. All right, go ahead. Tell us about your organization and everything you got going. You got a book.
Yes, I do have a book.
Yeah. Did you bring it with you?
I did not. It's called The Bait to Get Your Meat. So nothing to do with this. I'm a dating strategist. But also, we have a program called Our Future for young men. Definitely go to ourfuture.com and get that information. We'd love to help. And I just want us, everybody, to stay encouraged and work on the vision that God has given you. Because everybody's mission is different. Whether it's small, just to pull the kids in your garage and teach them how to change a tire. Everything is important. You may just be the inspiration that plants the seed in the next Martin Luther King. So never think the small things are not important. So that's just really what I want to share.
And with that said, the small things not important. The fact that your book is what, Bait to Get Your Mate?
Right, The Bait to Get Your Mate.
So let's not look at that as being an unimportant thing, because, you know, we live in a society right now that's all about relationships, especially. So, A Bait to Get Your Mate is the name of Charmaine's book. So, sounds like it's sold out.
Yes, and I'll be back, because we need to talk about the book.
She will be back.
I want to be on that show. I do.
Now,
Summit to Save Lives Incorporated. I will simply say to the audience, 678-896-3123. Or you can send something in the mail, Post Office Box 42955, Atlanta, Georgia 303-30311. And if you got someone in the system of going to court or just have some issues at home, call us and so we can come and actually empower people with the knowledge and understanding so that they can find wisdom and how to conquer that thing. Mm-hmm. Sometimes things won't never go away, but we can learn how to be empowered greater than those things.
Yeah.
And that won't cause the same old crazy effect all the time. Amen. Mm-hmm.
Amen.
So in the sense of that, and the sense of what he just said, I need this because I'll get to preaching.
Yeah.
Amen. Mm-hmm. I want to say to Pastor Jackson, I want to say to this sister right here, and I want to say to anybody else out there, let's come together. And at least for the young people, for the young men, I want to fill up the dome with nothing but young men so we can teach them. We can get them from probation. We can get them from parole. We can get them out of jail. We can get them out of the court. We can find them on the street. We can find them in the home. They're everywhere. As a matter of fact, they're our future. Mm-hmm. And God has covered our communities with these young folks, and we just need to go get them. They're mm-hmm. waiting, and they're ripe for us. Amen?
Amen.
And I'm going to end that on that note right there.
And they really are hungry for knowledge.
Hungry, brother.
They're hungry for wisdom. I love going to the jail twice a week and talking to these young brothers, you know, because once they realize that you're there to help them and there's no agenda,
right?
You know, and sometimes even if they think it's an agenda, it don't matter.
Right.
They are hungry for wisdom.
You need to take me with you.
We'd love to take you with you with us. Yeah. We'd have to pave the way because you'd be a distraction, but we need you. We really do need women to come because the young ladies also have
Absolutely.
Issues.
Absolutely.
So, and we don't want to overlook that factor. You know, our young girls need us as well.
Young girls and young guys. Yeah.
Just as much, you know. I really appreciate you guys joining me tonight. And yeah, I think we're probably coming up on the hour, and I appreciate Pastor Jackson for calling in. I also appreciate Miss Chantilly, a Man Cave fan, for calling in and posing an excellent question. You know, excellent question. Wow. And we thank everybody for joining us tonight. We had a few people here at the audience, and we appreciate everyone coming out. I know it is a Saturday night, so it's hard to get people to sit down and listen to some things that might help them on a Saturday night. We have to bring them in on nonsense on Saturday nights, and maybe during the week we'll talk about some relevant things, you know. But so we're going to have us a party in the man cave. Maybe we'll have us a relationship party in the man cave. Yeah. So thanks, guys, for joining us, and stay tuned for the next Man Cave show, and we will be coming to a neighborhood near you very soon. Thank you, and good night.
Nobody greater, nobody greater than you.
So much. Yeah.
Nobody can hear me.
Yes, sir.
Like you can. Oh, most holy one, you are the great I am. Awesome in all your ways, and mighty is your hand. You are he who carried out redemption's plan.